They say that it's hard to do something, whatever it is that you want to do. Have you noticed that? Not just that it's hard, they say it takes luck. Everything is a million to one shot, apparently. Or worse, hundreds of millions, billions, I don't know. Odds like that, it's a wonder anything happens at all. It's a wonder we're even here, or anything is here. But we are here, and here is here. We must not be very good listeners. I think we're here to not listen, to go for it anyway, whatever it is that we want, and probability be damned. That's how anything happens, from a starfish to making it, whether making it is getting laid in high school or becoming a Hollywood starlet. We all have our goal. I know mine. I want to be eaten by a fucking shark. I begin my journey at Coney Island, as good a place as any to start, and as good a place as any to die. In fact, arguably a fitting one. An amusement park of sorts on the sea, where I have come to deliver the ultimate amusement, a woman being eaten by a fucking shark. A common occurrence if you ask cinema, but rare if you ask, I don't know, reality. It virtually never happens. Not just a woman being eaten by a shark, but anyone. Of course, odds can go fuck themselves, though. I'm here to break them like wild horses and ride them into the sunset of my own spectacular death. Coney Island is not a place I much care for, by the way. Sure, there's a certain majesty to some of the old structures. I can get down with those or whatever. But though they themselves are huge, they are a small part of the place. Mostly, it's just a litter box. A litter box where the pussy of the world comes to shit. I don't even know what that means. I don't even think it makes any sense. It just fell out of me. But it felt right. It sounded right. I guess what I'm imagining is all sorts of women with pussies, and who are themselves pussy, shitting cat-like into the sand. Maybe I wasn't even imagining that. Maybe I just like the bare words of what I said, divorced of needing to have any real meaning or visual. Words that sound like something you'd randomly overhear at Coney Island. A place that doesn't make sense. A place in a constant, reliable state of failure at all the things it's supposed to be, and so much so that perhaps a miracle could happen here one day. Maybe today. If it were a slot machine, or a bodega for buying scratch-offs at, it'd be the opposite of burnt. Burnt, of course, meaning a place that has had a recent big win or wins, and as such, isn't due again for a while. I might get lucky here. I unhook the straps of my overalls. I unbutton one side of the overalls, and I slide them down my legs, past the scars on my thighs, the one absurdly big one, and the little ones next to it. They say you stop thinking about your scars eventually, but these I think of constantly. They are so often wrong about literally everything. I take off my clean white t-shirt, which still smells like bleach, and which I hope will still smell that way later, and not now smell like this disgusting beach, if I do not die today and I have to put it back on. I fix my bikini top over my smallish breasts. I hold the crook of my arm suddenly, inexplicably nervously. I stare forward at my awareness of my own existence. It's actually not as bad here as I remembered. I feel kind of peacefully alone. There's so much expanse of kitty litter, and since everyone seems to congregate at specific small areas, there's wide gaps where you can be by yourself. There are definitely worse places to be in this world. I could be on my bed, staring into my laptop or my phone, for instance, but no. I'm out here making things happen. I'm willing a reality I want into existence. Somewhere out there is the shark for me, and we'll find each other here. And if not here, then somewhere. And we'll meet, teeth to my flesh, and I will be meat, no longer a person, but dinner. I learn to read. Not just that, but to count, add, subtract, multiply, and divide. I made friends and enemies. I worried about things. I worked for a living. I studied facts about certain subjects. I formed opinions. I mourned loved ones, dead and not dead. All of this, gone in the moment where I will be meat. My parents having fallen in love so long ago, and having gone through so much to raise me, unbeknownst to them just to prepare a meal for a beast that barely ever eats, or even bites humans anyway. But will eat me. I know it will. I become aware of a growing number of people around me. It's fairly late into the day, and yet people are arriving, coming. And the people that were already near me seem closer than they seemed when I chose this spot, and louder. I can damn near hear their lips flapping as their words come out. Two tattooed women are having a conversation about who cares what. I stare and can't help but think about their bodies having been entered so many times by needles in order to make the art that adorns them. In and out, over and over, an incomprehensible amount of times. Penetration on a near-infinite, fractal level. There is a woman standing, staring forward, in a multicolored bikini, with red hair, and she's staring forward so loudly, She's saying sentences with her eyes damn near. I feel like the slightest grain of sand could brush past her and she would have a conversation with it, so obviously desperate and off-puttingly extroverted as she is. I do not like this woman. Her earrings are nice, though. I can see them from here. They're bottle caps with some sort of green, real or fake jewel in them. They're the kind of thing she probably found beautiful as a kid and still finds beautiful. I wish all of her gave me the same feeling that that realization gives me. I would fall in love with her right now and here. I wonder what the tattooed women with the lips flapping look like from where the green earring woman is standing. I wonder if they seem more sympathetic, more alluring. Life is often all about where you are, where exactly you are. You could fall in love or annoyance with a stranger at a party just based on where you're standing, your vantage point of them. That's how I know I could never make a movie. Where would I even put the camera? Seemingly infinite places to stick it. Not like sex, where there's just three holes and I guess change if you count cleavage. Not to mention all the holes we can never penetrate. Our body is covered with millions of pores, but you can't exactly have sex with those. Closest you can come is get tattoos. Maybe these bitches understand something I don't. I lay back and think about the tattooed women, but I can't even see them. My eyes are closed, and I just saw them, but I can't see anything. And I suddenly feel so alone with myself in a not enjoyable way, as I remember my implacable disability. My whole life, I've had this weird thing where I can't picture things visually if my eyes are closed. I'm very intelligent, and when my eyes are open, I can see what's in front of me very vividly, and even simultaneously picture other things in my head very vividly. But when my eyes are closed, I'm in the dark. Anytime I've brought this up to a doctor, they just say that it's not an actual thing, and that it's just a stress or anxiety thing. They say that I'm overthinking it, which kind of just means they think I'm faking it. Apparently, it's only an actual thing. Aphantasia, it's called. If you can't picture anything in your mind whatsoever. Part of how I got into sharks is that I started doing research on my thing, and I looked up animals that never closed their eyes, and sharks came up. I say part of how because really it was a time in my life when a million different things, explorations, kept bringing me to sharks. Every time I'd think about something, and then look up something, I'd eventually end up at sharks. Or when I'd browse around for a movie to watch, I'd come across a shark movie, of which there are like a million these days. A non-believer would say that I'm victim to some sort of algorithm, or that my phone is listening to me and simply showing me shark stuff. But I don't think it's that. Or at least not entirely that. I think there's a ghost in the machine, so to speak. I'm not insane. I don't think that God wants me to be eaten by a shark, per se, or even thinks it's a good idea. But I do think that God supports me in my pursuit of happiness. I open my eyes and see that the red one has found her person to talk to now, and that person is the rhythm, the beat, the melody, the lyrics of some music that has started blasting from wherever. She's got a big, fat, ice-cold bottle of water in her hand out of nowhere, and she is grooving. I don't care about the music. I wish I couldn't hear it at all. But I care about what it's doing to her, and her to me. I can see what our life would be like together, or at least what parties or weddings would be like. Her out on the dance floor and me sitting at one of the tables, eating or drinking. Resentment would grow out of that no matter how much we loved each other, as is what happened with my parents. If my mother had simply not had legs, they probably would have been together forever. I wish the red one would look over at me, but I know that she would never. She's one of those women that perceives a beautiful woman her level or higher like me only in their peripherals and never makes it their actuals. It's a game they play in their heads of whichever woman approaches first is the lesser woman. I hate that game. And now the tattooed ones are kind of dancing too, gyrating, acknowledging the red one. A triangle is being formed in the air, floating invisible lines that connect them to one another, and I can't lay down for this anymore. I can't even be stoic. I'm losing it. I wish people didn't bother me so much. I wish external stimuli in general didn't bother me so much. I have a creative mind, I know that. I am an effortlessly creative and complex individual, able to take stimuli in and make stimulemonade. My thoughts are as worthwhile and interesting as I am beautiful. But all I really want to do is shut it all off. It's not suicide if you're feeding something. It's not suicide if you're food. It can't be. No religion in the world would convict. And only I would know the beauty and intention of the act being committed. Like my thoughts, it would be art for me and me only. And then I would be gone. And now the red one has left and the tattooed ones are standing and just talking. And the music is eerily gone, too. As though it had been coming out of the red one this whole time. It's weird how people can just stand and talk, so enthusiastically and so often about nothing. Whenever I get stuck in a situation of that, in seconds I'm just thinking about sharks. And then if I have the opportunity to steer the conversation somewhere, I'm steering it to sharks. It's a thing a child might do, and I guess I've never lost that part of me, though I of course came into my shark interest way later in life. It's also very genuine. It's not me trying to be cute or quirky or memorable or different. And it's not like I don't have thoughts on other topics and things I could add to a conversation about them. I'd just rather not share them. I like that they're only ever in my own head. Particularly because I don't mind holding contrasting opinions and being a bit hypocritical. I contain multitudes, as the saying goes. That's so frowned upon by most people. You're seen almost as a cheater, like you're being unfaithful to the partner that has some of your ideas. They get mad that you're not firmly on a side of us or them, whatever that may constitute in regards to a particular topic. They want to be able to quickly determine if you're an ally or an enemy, when in actuality, you're neither. You're simply more human than they are, which upsets them as they suddenly realize how much of themselves they lost by joining up with whatever side they joined up with. I close my eyes for a moment, and when I open them, it's just one of the two tattoos that's around anymore. The Asian one in the blue has suddenly disappeared, evaporated, and the other one is sitting down now, dicking around on her phone. Maybe my eyes had been closed for longer than I realized. She's really quite beautiful, and her big tattoo is pretty amazing. She'd be quite alluring to me if she just put her phone down. You're at the beach. The rest of your life, and the rest of the world, shouldn't matter here. Drop that glass sliver of soap and let yourself be entered by the present. Most of all so that I can more properly ogle you. I don't consider myself a lesbian, or bisexual, or anything. All I consider myself is creative. My romantic or sexual impulses belong to me and originate from me. Sure, looking at someone beautiful helps get the gears to start turning, but I do believe that I do something with their beauty inside of me, alchemize it in some way, and I am more reacting to that with attraction than I am to the person themselves. I don't think that I am alone in that regard. I think other people probably do it too, but have no awareness that they do it, and maybe never will. Creativity is so often misunderstood, or unexplored, or belittled, when really I'm pretty sure it's the most important thing in the world. A genuine creative impulse is next to godliness. I get some of my best ideas while looking at women, and I'm more receptive to my own ideas while looking at women, too. The persuasiveness of the female form acting like a gel cap for the idea. I think I first got the idea that I wanted to be eaten by a shark while looking at myself in a mirror. In the romance of my mind, it was a giant round mirror with a gold frame, and I was in a sheer gown, lit perfectly with three-point lighting. In reality, I think it was my dirty medicine cabinet mirror after I had just peed and washed my hands, and I was wearing an oversized t-shirt from a dollar store and plaid sleep pants. I probably looked like hell. Yes, I can look like hell. I think it was late at night or early in the morning, amidst one of my shark movie marathons or shark research marathon sessions. Yes, the internet can be good for something. But even me in my unattractive state, the idea grabbed me hard and didn't let go. Some ideas are just that good. Gazing at this woman now, really the only idea I have is to get up and go over to her and love her. Not make love to her. Not yet. Just love her. Speak to her with love and warm her by it such that everything she says to me is with a bit of a smirk because she feels so good and can't contain it. She's a beautiful woman, and I bet she would let me touch her. I am a beautiful woman. Beautiful women should touch other beautiful women. It should happen all the time, everywhere, like breathing. We should all be in one big, unspoken, tacitly understood relationship that exists beyond any actual committed relationship we are in at any given time, and is respected as higher than any. To say that I'm a romantic is to put it lightly. Lighter than the beautiful little golden hairs on her lower back. And if ever I am to die in the way that I want to, I really need to start learning how to kill this part of me and keep my eyes on the prize. I go over to the water. I need to look for a shark. And by that I don't mean looking for a fin peeking out of the water like in a movie. I mean actually vibing with the ocean in front of me and being able to tell if there's one out there. One out there for me. The one. The truth of the matter with sharks is, since they so rarely eat or even bite humans, one would assume they're just not around us much. And while there's some truth to that, what's more true is that they're around us way more than we realize. They pretty much just chill underwater. They really don't do that fin above the surface thing. And it's not like you dip your head under the seawater and it's well lit like a department store down there. You typically can't see shit. But stuff is down there a lot. And some of that stuff is a shark sometimes. Waiting is key in life. Waiting is one of those things they should teach in school but don't. I mean an actual class called waiting, with a remedial class and a regular class and an AP class. People would do so much better in life if they just learned how to wait. And I will succeed at my goal because I am a good waiter. I don't mean I'm good at taking people's orders, and bringing people food, and getting my ass pinched. I mean I'm like those people you see waiting for buses, but better. Because sharks are better than buses, and dying is better than just going somewhere, probably. When I was a kid, my parents used to take me to the beach. I have memories of it. I can remember my mom always wearing a black one piece. I can remember my dad in red trunks or something. I can remember my mom putting suntan lotion on me. I can remember the cucumber sandwiches she used to make. It kind of hurts to think about this stuff because it's about a myself that I don't relate to. I was such a different person back then. I mean, I was a kid, so yeah. And I of course wasn't even obsessed with sharks yet. I had no idea such human-like beasts existed. I mean, I knew sharks existed, but I definitely thought of them as just fish. As an enlightened adult now, I know that sharks are practically human. They behave in the water kind of like a human who were a fish might. This is not just stupid me bullshit. Marine biologists actually think about sharks in that way, too. It'd be a whole long thing to go into why they're human-like, so just trust me, they're human-like. And they treat us like peers for the most part, sharks do. It's good to treat people like peers for the most part in life. It's close to sharkliness. The red one is standing and being the red one. And I walk around a little bit, kind of a half circle around her, and then I go in. I ask her if she's seen any sharks. At first I probably come off like a nervous Nelly, but as it goes on she detects my eagerness and sees that I'm not just some pussy. I'm someone with a genuine, unique interest in them. And that magnetizes the Asian one probably, because she's over here now and getting into the convo. And she doesn't read me as quickly. It takes her a little while to see what I'm all about, but slowly she starts to get it. I'm interesting and I know things. And I hold court like that for a while, just sharing things about sharks that are wonderful. I don't quite have them in the palm of my hand, but I do have them in there in some capacity. Me, the most interesting of us three sunglassed bitches, and as such, rocking the mic. The convo sort of devolves into the red one show, though, as she starts to talk a lot, not really saying as many interesting things pertaining to sharks as I, but filibustering by using a lot of extraneous words to cover for that. It's lame and kind of whack and I don't like it, but I play the part of someone just listening and being okay with it, because this is probably all she has. This is probably her only way of convoing. It's sad, really, and it's times like these I remember I'm not as socially inept as I sometimes feel. There's always a smaller fish. Her whole put-on aura to her voice and body language is that she's so worldly and experienced, and I hate that she can't tell from one look at me that what she pretends to be, I am, actually. I've gotten late at manners. Actual manners. I've undressed equestrian attire and fencing attire off of men who loved me and wanted to marry me, whereas she's probably only ever slid jeans off a dude. And that's fine. Whatever. But the fact is, I'm a 900-page novel and she's just a pamphlet at best. I'm someone something should be about. A work of literature, a film, a miniseries. I deserve length, and boy, I've had it. I've lived like a porn star before, but without the camera and the crew. Just life. I've never done a single drug, and I don't drink. I'm that fucking cool. I've never had an STD or an STI or any of that in my life, and I genuinely believe that it's impossible for my body to. It's hard to explain. The point is, I should be studied, and I hate situations like these where I'm not. Eventually, I say I have to go, and I get out of there. I'm super nice about it, too. And I do some walking back, and I see the other one, looking for the Asian one, probably. And I come over and talk to her, and her energy is like she never in a million years expected I would ever come over and talk to her, which is a great way to start. I love that. This is already way better than whatever the hell that last convo was. And I'm asking her if she's seen any sharks around, and of course she hasn't, but it's a good opening line, I feel like. And I keep talking about sharks more, but she seems like maybe she's scared of them. Definitely one of those phobia-type people who are scared of spiders or dogs or something, but for sharks. Just totally unnerved by having to have a conversation about them, even. I'm drying up her interest in me, really, and so I steer the conversation to just general stuff about the beach. And she starts relaxing. But I'm not really enjoying the general stuff. It's not my style, so this isn't going to work out. This is the best day of her life, and she thinks she's going to have an unforgettable romantic encounter with an amazing female stranger, but this isn't going to work out. I will have to part ways from this convo pronto, and I will be super nice about it. And she will be disappointed, but we'll cover that up fully with niceness, as her dream of me and her together is dashed, like in cartoons when a thought bubble gets popped by a pin. I actually walk around with her for a little bit first before letting her down and parting, though. Just walking and talking, me doing my best to stomach non-shark talk. And the Asian one comes back to that general spot and is looking around for her, which I see out of the corner of my eye from afar. But my walking and talking partner doesn't, because she's so transfixed with me. But I see the Asian, and I think about what walking and talking with the Asian would be like. But then I stop thinking about it, because I don't actually care. She's cute, and she would be fun, but I don't actually care. And I finally do end the walk and talk with the one I'm with, and I do so really nicely, a nice parting of ways. And then I pack up my shit and get out of that general area. I can't stop thinking about the red one, though. Now away from her, I like her more than I actually did at any given time or instance of being around her. I'm staring off at nothing, and I can see her perfectly in my head, and she's just perfection. One of the greats, really. And in my mind, she has her mouth closed. And her with her mouth closed is as close to perfection as any woman could probably ever come who isn't me. She should have no thoughts, ever. No spoken language, no appetite, no excrement. She should just lay and exist and be beautiful, and belong to me. Nothing should ever enter her, I've decided. She should just be rubbed. Her only penetration should be through massage, sensuous touch, and oils entering her skin. I'll be thinking about her for some time, but really, I probably won't. I probably will never think about her again, or of my fucked up beautiful words about her in my head that no one will ever hear. The journey goes on, the journey goes on. There are many fish in the sea as far as beaches to go to, and I will find the fish, the beach, for me. And my shark will be there. Maybe tomorrow will be the beach. Maybe tomorrow will be the day. Maybe tomorrow I die. Manhattan Beach is not in Manhattan. It's firmly in Brooklyn, apparently. I'd never heard of it, or if I did, I guess I figured it was in Manhattan and was probably just a pier and some big rocks or something. But no, it's in Brooklyn, and it's an actual beach. And it's not far from Coney Island, but it's very far from Coney Island. Very different vibe here. I barely feel like the same person I was there. My desire is the same. My want and need of a shark, and why, hasn't waned. But I feel less irritated, less on edge. It's a chill, introspective place here. There are families here. There is that whole energy. But I don't feel bothered by anyone or anything. Maybe it'll be different over by the water's edge, but right here on the sand I feel contemplative and can kind of just be with myself. A few other women are doing the same. I am definitely not the first woman to have realized this about this place, apparently. It seems like women who do realize it don't share the realization, lest here become full of women, and thus, a destination for men to come and bother them. That lack of sharing means less women gaining this place as an oasis, a solace, but maybe few women actually deserve it as one, anyway. I feel very lucky to have stumbled upon here, and luck is of course a very encouraging thing. The luck of me finding here could lead to the luck of me finding a shark here. I often think about how exactly I'll get it to eat me when I'm out there in the water, and it's there too. It's not like I'm going to be covered in chopped up fish or anything. I have no desire whatsoever in tricking it into eating me. This must happen out of both it and my own volition. Probably like sex or childbirth, my body will just know what to do. Not that I was designed to be eaten by a shark, but I do believe my sheer will and desire has conditioned me in some way towards that, if not physically, then vibrationally. And sharks are extraordinarily skilled at picking up on your, or anything's, energy. My theory is that that's why sharks so rarely eat people. They can tell that we don't want to be eaten and are respectful of that. For all we know, the animals they do eat could be swimming around all day begging to die through their energy, and sharks are simply granting them their wish. The ocean is a rough place, and a fish being suicidal would totally make sense. The water here is full of people standing around, splashing a bit, swimming a bit. Families, like I mentioned before. No sharks are attacking, of course. I really can't stress enough how rare shark attacks are. You can say it a million times, you can show the statistics a million times that only a couple dozen people are bitten every year and almost none of those fatally, but people don't believe you. The anti-shark propaganda that pervades movies and the news is too strong. Meanwhile, of course, something like 500,000 humans are murdered by other humans every year. Not to mention the fact that, oh, humans kill 100 million sharks a year, completely needlessly. Sharks are not your enemy. Your fellow man is. I say, in my head, to an audience of no one but myself. It's probably for the best, because people don't deserve me, or any pieces of me. My brilliant words are often lost on them, and I am just a piece of ass in their eyes. And people don't even deserve that piece. I give it away anyway, though. While I'm still alive, it just makes sense to. Anyone who significantly wants to die understands. My death just wouldn't mean as much to me if I weren't taking something away from others by doing it. And my body and face sure do bring people so much joy. I've made people's entire days, weeks, months, years, decades before, and I mean just the sight of me fully clothed. In a bikini like this? Forget about it. Men glimpsing me today will one day tell their grandkids about me. The grandkids will ask, "Do you mean grandma?" "No, not grandma," they'll reply. And then die. The grandpa is on his deathbed in this scenario. Some fucking guys come up to me and ask me for the time. I don't have a watch on, because of course I don't. They probably wanted me to go get my phone and check, as an end to then asking me for my number. Because I don't get my phone, they switch gears and just ask me what I'm looking at. And so I tell them the truth. I'm looking for sharks. They are now firmly in my hands and belong to me, but don't know it yet. They bluff a little, pretending to have seen sharks here before. These guys are ironic and sarcastic. Somebody once told them to be like that in order to be interesting to women. That person was probably being ironic and sarcastic with them. I play along with their little improv, and they probably think that I have a good sense of humor, and I'm a good straight man, and know about the yes-and rule and whatnot. In actuality, I am probably the most sincere woman they have ever had a conversation with. And I steer the shark conversation easily and effortlessly toward the plight of sharks due to the billion-dollar shark fin industry. We are no longer on an improv stage. We are in my hands, and I am speaking from a soapbox. Shark fins are tasteless and useless to man except as a status symbol, shoved as an ingredient into soup for no good reason at all. Shark fin soup is a traditional, stupid dish that is very popular amongst the world's rich, and very expensive, and very destructive. Sharks have their fins sliced off and then are tossed back into the ocean, finless, as though fins grow back like starfish arms. They don't. The sharks just die. It's a horrific process, and it has decimated 90% of the world's sharks in just the last couple decades or something like that. I forget the exact numbers because every time I look the shit up, I just cry. Look it up yourself if you want to learn more. I say to no one, of course. But I am telling these boys the same shit, so maybe these boys will. They won't, though. Instead, they'll just do what most people do when confronted with the awful behavior of man. Make up some excuse to walk away and ignore it. The history of the world is literally just that, over and over. The horny skinny idiots gone, I go and dip my toes in the water, high on the fact that they are somewhere still thinking about me, and will be thinking about me for the rest of their day, and will be thinking about me for the rest of their days. I will always be that shark girl they met on Manhattan Beach that one time, and I will always be someone they would drop any subsequent girlfriend or wife of theirs to be with just once. I am the one that got away, without them even getting the chance to fall in love with me. It's incredible what a woman can do to a man from practically nothing at all, like a professional killer who can kill you with a pen. We should be destroying men like this any chance we get, and we probably often do without even meaning to. The water is kind of oppressive. Not so much the water itself, but the pebbles underneath. They hurt the feet, and I'm actually kind of surprised there's so many people out in the water, every one of them in pain right now. What crazy people. What a crazy beach this is. Just pebbles everywhere by the water and in it. This is not the kind of pain I like or want. Every step taken is a nightmare, and every standing still is a nightmare too. And the water is too shallow to just swim around in and avoid the pebbles. I'd rather walk the concrete streets of Manhattan barefoot than walk barefoot here at Manhattan Beach. And it's like all these people here are under some spell of denial, or maybe they believe they don't deserve a good, normal beach or something. I can't figure it out, and it scares me that I can't figure it out. I almost want to find those skinny boys just to have someone to talk to about this shit, because something is seriously fucked up here, and them being seemingly outsiders to this place too, ironic and sarcastic as they are, might understand. I come back in and stand for a while just looking out at the water of this useless beach. The sand far from the water was nice, but I just don't get the appeal of anything by the water or in it. And furthermore, no one is checking me out of this place or trying to get with me other than those two dorky dudes, and I am by far the hottest and skimpiest dressed woman here. Everyone is just so engrossed with their families, even the dads that seem like they probably hate their families. I'm a fucking ghost here, and if this were what being dead were like, I'd never want to be it. I'd just stay alive and live in a plastic bubble, eating right and exercising and refusing to show emotion on my face of any kind so that I never age. I'd live to be 200 years old. Luckily, this ghostly feeling is not what death is like. I'm no expert, I've never died, but I can tell. I know that death will lead to someplace I'll enjoy, and that being eaten by a shark won't be the only part about death that I like. Even if it just ends up being a heaven or hell type deal, something as on the nose as that, I know I'd be able to find my place. Even in hell I find a click, I'd find a torture I didn't mind so much. But I can't find my place here. I do not understand Manhattan Beach, and I know that no shark ever would. If there has ever been a shark sighting in the history of this beach, I'd be insanely fucking surprised. Yes, some sharks do like shallow water, so it's a candidate on paper. But holy fuck, only a family could ever love this place. Even a lonely woman out on the sand being amongst herself and her own thoughts, I feel like once her toes come over here to the edge, she'd never come back. Which explains why there's only a few alone women here. You feel this place a little and like it, and then you feel it entirely and you never want to come back. You feel betrayed. I definitely do. I stand around a lot longer, just staring out at the water. The light waning is kind of beautiful, but not beautiful enough. Maybe I'm waiting for the skinny boys to come back, though I know they're probably long gone. Maybe I'm trying to absorb the energy of these families and understand what makes them how they are, so able to withstand pebble pain and so focused on their little family unit. Maybe I'm holding out hope for a shark's energy suddenly out there in the water, this place being such a bust that maybe it's a test from the cosmos to see how bad I really want this. Will I stand here bored for hours and then wade across awful pebbles for it, kind of thing. I doubt it, though. The cosmos knows I'm the real deal. So maybe I'm still standing here because I just don't have anything else going on today or tonight. But that could describe pretty much any day or night. Really, I am my only plans ever. And as the depression of that thought creeps over me like the darkness creeping over this place as the sun goes down, I more than ever just want death to lead the blackness. Not an atheist, no awareness of it type blackness. I mean a full and total awareness of being in nothingness forever, sudden and dark. Brighton Beach is between Coney Island and Manhattan Beach. It's connected to Coney Island, same strip of sand belonging to both, whereas Manhattan Beach is separated from Brighton by a bunch of houses or whatever for a bunch of blocks. Brighton Beach definitely doesn't feel like Manhattan Beach, and surprisingly doesn't feel at all like Coney Island, despite being connected to it. I don't know how to explain it, but the second you get here you just feel like you're in a different, yellowier decade or something. Maybe it's the light hitting off the buildings around here. Maybe it's an aura, a ghost hovering over it all. All I know is that here I feel like I'm in the 70s, and also the 50s, and also the 40s. I feel like I'm encroaching on some place that doesn't belong to me as a present-day woman, even though there are plenty of other present-day women like me here. I'm not surprised that I haven't died yet. Not just as far as me being eaten by a shark, but in general. I've done so many dangerous things in my life and not died that I know the universe has a plan for me. I certainly doubt that plan is for me to be eaten by a shark, but I see fate as just a suggestion, anyway. We as humans can, and often do, fuck with the best laid plans of this thing called life. I don't think we were ever meant to eat meat, for one thing. When I hear Garden of Eden, I don't exactly think animals. Fruits and vegetation and whatnot to feed us, and flowers and herbs to heal us. Not that hard to understand. And yet, I'll bring this up to religious folk, pastors or whatever, and they'll look at me like I'm the devil. Maybe not the devil, but they'll look at me, and I don't like it. I don't like when people who aren't interested in having sex with me look at me. It makes me uncomfortable. It's like they're seeing horns on my head or something, whereas oglers, to their credit, always make me feel like I have wings and a halo. Anyway, the point is, I believe my wanting to be eaten by a shark is way less of an aberration from God's plan than people eating meat, by a wide margin. There's a lot of people here, but I'm away from most of them. There's some bitches around me. Maybe not bitches, they seem fine, but yeah, they're around me and it's unavoidable. This just felt like the spot for me, and they just happen to be nearby. They're definitely a distance from me where they probably won't talk to me, though, which is good. I'm not here to make friends. I'm here to die. There's a blondie and then another blondie not far behind who is older, and I get the vibe that they're related or something, mother and daughter, but the younger one is at an age where she just wants to be alone at the beach but still needs a ride there. I don't know. Maybe they're just complete strangers that are locked in some sort of unintended symmetry, just happening to both be reading books and be in front of one another and be blonde. Maybe they were mother and daughter in a past life. I don't know. They're kind of weirding me out. I feel like the older one should just adopt the younger one or something, even if the younger one has parents already. I'd feel better about them if that would happen. There's an orange swimsuit young lady on an orange towel who kinda rocks. I like how the shades of orange aren't exactly the same but still go together. I like her whole energy. I like how her legs are. I wish I could go on a road trip with her, and that she would sit exactly like that on the hood of our car while we were stopped at some lookout point. She'd look so fucking hot like that. Not that she doesn't look hot right now. I don't even actually feel turned on by this fantasy of her, by the way. I don't even feel particularly horny today. I'm just trying to pay her a compliment, and I'm so used to thinking in such a horned up way that it just comes out like that by default. She's a beautiful girl who probably has no idea how fucking truly, utterly beautiful and fun she is all I'm trying to say. Leave me alone. She's a woman that could be my best friend. Leave me alone. Some fucking other young woman comes over and sits down so damn close to me, and she's got big melon breasts and they jiggle like actual melons don't, actually. And they're definitely real, and she's definitely real. Definitely fucking seriously not realizing how fucking encroaching she's being right now on my whole personal space. Just some oblivious, dumb lady all stripes and no sense. And without her fucking shirt on, it's like her breasts are even bigger. They just keep getting bigger the more clothes she takes off, like some demented anime fantasy. These stupid, ever-expanding, bountiful breasts. I am jealous a bit, but also I am glad that I don't have them because I'd be so sad if a shark bit them off. It would ruin the whole experience of dying if that were one of the last images of my life. I can't stop watching her. I can't stop looking at all her stuff and looking at her. And there is no way in hell she is ever going to look at me. She is so in her own world, despite being so close to me. Frankly, it's kind of insulting, like I don't matter just because I don't have giant melon breasts. I feel like if I did have them, she'd have said nice day to me by now with a smile, out of fellow melon breast solidarity and whatnot. But because I'm a perfect 10 who simply doesn't have large breasts, she thinks she's better than me? Bitch, I will end you. I will scratch your perfect, flawless breast flesh so bad they'll scar up and people will think they're covered in ugly stretch marks. Don't even try me, you lucky weirdo. Actually, I've always thought stretch marks look kinda cool. They kind of look like scars from an animal attack, which is badass. I saw a movie once where a guy said that in it, just a throwaway line of dialogue, and I never forgot it because it was so correct. Sometimes movies can... Some other bitch is now coming and being here, right next to me, just like the boob lady but on my other side. And her hair is kind of like mine. I like mine better, but hers isn't far behind. And her towel is cooler than mine, I will admit. My towel is kind of shit. And she has no idea I exist. She's just doing her thing, and I am just sand next to her, that's all I am. And she has great legs. All these women being so close to me is starting to feel like I'm underneath a pile of them, and not in a fun way. I feel like a person. Worse, I feel like a person who is just a person, which is insane to think about. I am great, I have purpose. I'm at this beach for a reason, and these women are at this beach for no reason at all. Even the faux mom and daughter who are reading, I mean. Reading doesn't count. None of these bitches' behavior fucking counts. I need to find my fucking shark. I was hopeful, optimistic, the last two beaches, but I am not hopeful here. I feel off. These bitches have fucked up my whole vibe. Even standing away from them, I've not recovered. And staring out into the water, I don't even want to go into it because I know that it won't happen today. And now the book daughter is coming over to me, and I'm waiting for her to say something. She asks me what I'm looking at. I tell her I'm looking for sharks. She is delighted, amused, clearly pleased to learn that not only am I beautiful, but I have a quirky sense of humor. She thinks I'm quick-witted, but really I'm just a person with clear direction and purpose. Whether or not she will ever understand that, I have no idea, but she is having a good time talking to me, and that is bringing my confidence back up. I could die today. I get too cocky with her. I tell her I want to be eaten by a shark, thinking that I can get away with doing so, that it'll just lead to more amusement at what a wit I am. I do not break, I do not wink, I do not walk it back. I hold firm to it, and she is turning on me. I can feel her turning, and yet I still do not lie and tell her I'm kidding. If she's weirded out by me, then so be it. And she definitely is. She tells me she hears her mother calling her and has to leave. Huh. Maybe that older blondie was her mother. I heard nothing, and I have exceptional hearing, so she probably made up the mother. It's probably just a coincidence that I thought about her and the other lady being related and then she said what she said. Coincidences can be signs, though, of course. Maybe I'm a bit psychic today. Maybe I'm able to read things, read goings-on. That could bode well for this day being the day. And a brief bit of joy overcomes me before I realize that the strongest vibe I am picking up on today, the strongest message I am hearing within me, is that I will not be eaten by a shark today. I think back to the one with the cool beach towel. I'm sure she's having a grand old time, not a care in the world. I'm sure she's relaxing on the beach like people do. No desire to die, no desire to be anywhere but alive and relaxing. I'm sure the book girl is sitting and reading, safely back in her world of literature. I am no longer on her mind, whereas books are forever. She's shaken me off like a flea, so little does she value people. When I come back, she will be there on her towel, reading and ignoring me, as though we never had a momentary connection at all. This type of girl is impenetrable. Nothing ever affects them, nothing is allowed in besides that which has been put onto a page. I get back and I was wrong about her, I'll admit. It turns out I affected her so much that she's straight up gone now. I am more powerful than I sometimes realize, apparently. And the faux mom is standing, staring out, almost like she's looking for her daughter. But I know that's a bust. I know they're just cosmically related and not biologically. And I know that she's not looking for sharks. I know that she's just taking in the world, and the wind, and the sun, because she feels like she should. It's a thing to do at a beach. And I decide that she's as good a second victim as any, and also that a second victim is needed at all. I would like to see just how far my power goes. I sit down in her shit. It's such a perfect, simple yet powerful thing. Arguably not even violence, arguably not even illegal. Civil disobedience or whatever. A protest against another person. And I will simply remain here and remain here for as long as I need to for her to go. My best stoic face on, perfectly blank in order for her to attach whatever she wants to me, and even form sympathy and concern. Then maybe fear, anger, whatever she needs to go through. I will not break no matter what she says to me. This stand I am taking will not end until she is gone. It's fucking brilliant, and I'm surprised more people don't do this. I don't know why anyone would need to, but still, it works. Maybe because I'm so beautiful. An ugly woman, or definitely a man, wouldn't give it the same energy. It'd be overboard. But for me, in my infinite beauty, it's perfect. I'm making this woman disappear with practically nothing at all. High on my own success, I go after the boob lady next. Still a sitting-based tactic, but a little different than the last. She is immediately shy, but pleased, that I am so near. Oh, how easily some people fold the moment you show them the least bit of attention and are trustworthily beautiful. I compliment her on her breasts. I go on about them, calling so much positive attention to them, and share how badly I feel about my own. This is not truly how I feel. I happen to enjoy my breasts, they feel right on me, but I am sharing a typical concern some women have. I am giving voice to the voiceless with my performance, so it is not technically a lie. My performance is great, and I can feel her getting uncomfortable as I go on and on about her breasts and my lack thereof. I've dashed all her hopes and dreams of what I would be like as a person. I've shown myself to be beautiful, but annoyingly, fatally insecure. I am successfully driving her away simply by not being a particularly good version of an attractive woman. We hotties must be humble and not envious. We must be chill and calm. The list goes on. It's really a princess role, a royalty thing. That's what the world expects of us tens. When we are not like that, we are quick to be hated. It's really one of the more difficult numbers to be as far as hotness because of that. One is probably the easiest. If you're a one, you're actually kind of hot in that you're so rare. You're barely human. You're a monster. Nothing is expected of you. Everything is uphill. When you're a 10, all you can do is disappoint. Best to weaponize that disappointment for moments like this. My next kill is the one with hair like me. This one will be tricky, as she is off in Dreamworld, or at least has her eyes closed. I will make her know I am here, though, and I won't even have to use words. First, she is confused at the sand being brushed onto her. Then she is happy, because I am a beautiful woman playing around with her. She's probably not a lesbian, or bi, but all women love to have playful, beautiful women in their lives. The idea of taking a rest and then waking up to an instant, gorgeous friend is irresistible. I don't really know where to go with what I'm doing, though. This is not enough, of course. She moves her hat away from the sand, though, and in that lies my opportunity, maybe. She hates the sand on her hat, and I will not respect that. and I put some sand on her beautiful beach towel as a second final straw, in case the first wasn't strawy enough. And she is going to get the fuck out of here. She is leaving the beach, and I've kicked her out of my life, and my power is growing stronger. Every bitch I eliminate, the more I feel connected to my own self and to the beach. My beam out towards the world that is the sea strengthening such that a shark will want to know me, will come here just to meet and destroy me, perceiving me to be too powerful a woman, too much of a threat to the fragile land of woman and man. I forgot about one of the women, and my power will not be fully formed until I destroy her too. It's hard for me to want to destroy her, though. As mentioned, I could see a life with her, out on the road. She is so damn lovable to me. Such a mix of kid sister and wise babysitter. This is the epitome of kill your darlings. I find her quite darling. I don't want to do it. But if she's got to go, she's got to go. I stare for a little while, planning my course of action. I do not immediately know how I will get rid of her, or rather, what way I would feel comfortable getting rid of her. I come over to her for more research. Maybe looking at her more closely, inspecting her, I will learn my in. The more I look at her, though, the more I just want to be a part of her life, her friend to the end. Fuck it. If knowing her means having to get rid of her, then I'd rather just never know her at all. It's what's best for both of us. I get rid of me instead of her. This place was a bust anyway, and I don't just mean that pair of knockers from before. I pack up and leave the beach. I'd always heard Reese Beach was just kind of whatever, but apparently I'd been lied to. It's fucking gorgeous. I almost don't even want to say so, even in just my mind, because maybe there are mind readers out there in the world that will hear. There is the exact, perfect amount of not many people here right now, despite how beautiful a place this is. How is this not a destination? Here's hoping it never becomes one. If you are listening, secretly spying on my thoughts, do not go here. I would love to die here, just like anybody would love to die on a big, beautiful bed with satin sheets of a sexy color. Deathbeds are stupid. Who would want to die in a hospital bed? Better to die like a mobster's wife or something, looking perfect and gorgeous and laying on gorgeousness and decadence. That is what hospital or hospice beds should look like. Part of the beauty of being eaten by a shark is that there is no place more beautiful to die than the ocean. Land does not compare. No matter where you are separate from the other land areas of the world. With an ocean death, though, even if you are not dying in a particularly beautiful area of the ocean, you are still somewhere that's part of it all. It's all connected. And when your soul leaves your body, pieces out of the motherfucker. I'd like to imagine it pieces out more gracefully in the ocean, like a water birth. It also just plain seems fitting that there should be gore to death, like how there's gore to birth. So being eaten by a shark satisfies that as well. Being eaten by a shark satisfies everything ever, period. It's the greatest thing that could ever happen to end a person. I wore an all-black romper here to hopefully help manifest the death that I seek. Plus, you never get to attend your own funeral. But I don't see why you can't wear black to your own death. If you are planning to die, that is. Just seems respectful to the dead, aka yourself. The water looks right for a shark. If I were a shark, I'd want to be here. If I were sharks, plural, I don't know that I'd want to be here, but a shark, singular, would. Sharks sometimes go on long excursions all by themselves, just checking areas out, and I think that this place would be right for that. It's funny. No one really knows why sharks do that, by the way. We know very little about the journeys animals in the ocean decide to embark on. They just kind of go places, and we come up with some ideas after the fact as to why they did it, but mostly we just shrug and move on. My thought is that they become attracted to some powerful energy far away. And maybe it's so far away that it's just taking a while to get here. I could be winning and I don't even know it yet. That is a healthy mindset, and if I do not die today, I should not see that as a failure, but a victory still on its way to me. As long as I keep showing up and putting myself out there, I cannot fail. All this trying to die stuff is really making me a better person, by the way. I don't mean a better person to others, that's subjective and dumb anyway. One should not worry themselves with the way they treat other people or how other people think of them. What I mean is me, in my own skin, living and dealing with hiccups and hurdles. I feel better at that. I feel more capable, which is saying a lot because I've always been a 10 not just in beauty but in self-esteem. I've known plenty of beauties, some even 11s or 12s, who hate themselves more than you could ever know. It's sad, really. Double digits, wasted. You can have it all and have nothing at all if you don't believe in yourself. Remember that long after I am gone. The water feels great. It feels like some sort of soup. Maybe pea soup. I like pea soup. Split pea or regular pea. I just like pea soup, whatever kind it is. The water is cold, though. I like warm soup. I know, I'm super unique like that. But I don't mind how cold this water is, because it's warm in its coldness. It's alive, it's vibrant. It's an organism, and a powerful one. I feel less living than it, even. It's seriously insane that I'm the only one in it right now. It's good shit. Don't get me wrong about this whole pursuit of mine, by the way. Sometimes I wish I could go to a beach without a care in the world. No purpose, no mission, just me being a girl. Alone and doing nothing. There's something honest and alluring about the purposelessness. I get it, totally. It makes sense as a way to be in this world if you have to be in it.
It's a quiet rebellion, a seductive subversion in its own right. My way is better, of course, but it's okay too.
Also, the thing about doing things alone, going to a restaurant alone, or a movie alone, for instance, is that it's secretly better. One of the best-kept secrets in life is that it's infinitely more pleasurable to do by yourself the things people drill into you must be done with a date or a group. Anyone who tells you that groups or dates make activities better is an unwitting propagandist for the industries that benefit. Industries that just want to sell lots of tickets and snacks, or just want to fill big restaurant tables. They do not have your best interest at heart, but I do. The food tastes better, the movies taste better, by yourself. Trust me. It's also impossible to fully express yourself if you're not alone. It's just gotta be you and nothing at all, not even pen and paper. People get so scared of their own thoughts which have no sound to anyone else and are not recorded in any way as they are had. People lay in bed, unable to sleep at night, because their brain is keeping them up. Well, it's keeping them up because they don't use their brain enough during the day, really use it. I sleep like a fucking baby because I'm constantly creating gold inside of myself and letting it wash away. I am full of death. Every thought I think, born and then dead. I'm a master at knowing who the fuck I am and what is inside of me. When I see women writing on the subway or whatever, tattooing their thoughts to paper, all I can think is how fucking frightened they are of themselves and of truly feeling, truly knowing what they even are. Total amateur hour. Put down the pad, you cunts of the world, and freely bleed into the ether. That sentence was poetry that just came from me, and it is gone now. Even my being proud of it is gone. I can't remember exactly how I phrased it, put it, syntaxed it. The moment has passed, and all that remains is me. And I may not remember exactly what I said, but I know myself even better having said it. And that's all that matters. Know yourself and then die. Know yourself and then die. That is why we're here. I almost wish I could write it down. Know yourself and then die. It's so good, but fuck it. Stare into the expanse of the ocean. Know that you are but surface growth. Know that anything worth a damn on this planet is down there and hasn't been found yet. 80% of the ocean is completely and utterly unexplored, which means we don't even know what this place we call Earth even is yet. We sit outside the door and barely peek in through the windows. I hate this fucking world. I hate this fucking world, and by world I mean the world of us, up here. This constructed realm. And not even constructed to check that 80% out. Pathetic. They say the human body is nearly 80% water. I think that means we know as little about ourselves as we know about the ocean. What a fucking failure of a mess of a species. And me atop all of us, unbeknownst to everyone. Me who should be president of everything. I should have Secret Service following me around at all times. I should be protected. Not that I want to be, but it would make sense for me to be, how sweet and correct my thoughts are. I should have a first lady. It would be too much for people if it were just me, in all of my beauty, in control of everything, alone. People need to see a couple, and it needs to be a woman that's by my side and not a man. A first man sounds like Adam or some shit, and I'm no fucking Eve. I'm not the first woman. If anything, I'm the last woman. That's how it feels sometimes. Like that when I turn out the lights on myself, all lights will go out. A dark age, a truly dark age. A total outage of life that I will have caused. But my people would understand that it's the right thing for me to do. I'd make them understand, my arm around a good woman by my side. She's just so cute that I can't not go and talk to her. Sometimes you just see someone and know that your bodies would look good together. A perfect match, like two cartoon characters drawn by the same cartoonist and finally finding each other. I'm not saying we're soulmates, I'm just saying what I'm saying. And I like the way her voice sounds, I like her whole whatever. We were just talking about the ocean, but we might as well be talking about something deeper. I know, what's deeper than the ocean? But I guess what I mean is that it's like we've known each other for quite some time already. Years, decades. She's a compatriot. We've done a lot together, and we'll do more. I don't normally tell people about myself, but I tell her about myself. I share opinions, facts. I choose words to say and say them aloud. She listens, having no idea how big this is for me, because I am a naturally confident and captivating speaker. Maybe I don't sound as good in life as I do in my head, but I still sound pretty good. My speaking voice kind of sounds like a mouse or some kind of rodent to me sometimes, as compared to how it sounds in my mind, but that's fine. There are way worse speaking voices out there. I like her speaking voice. She tells me that she has to go and I am honestly motherfuckingly taken aback a bit. I thought I was killing. And she makes no attempt to get a number from me, or even a name, or anything. I am just a stranger she has spoken with, in her eyes. I will become nothing in her life. Maybe I was too enthusiastic. Maybe she has diarrhea. I don't fucking know and I never will. It's fucked up. It's fucked up. It's fucked up. Putting yourself out there. Showing someone the gold you have within you and them not knowing how significant and rare a thing that is for you to do. And maybe not even seeing it as gold, just seeing it as like gold-colored crayon. That stupid letdown of a crayon that everyone hated. Just shit on paper. Totally terrible writing implement. Yes, I'm trying to change the subject a bit because I'm hurt. I am hurt and I am alone, I'll admit it. And I'd like to cry, but I am outdoors, in the land of the living, so I'll just stare at the ocean for a shark to maybe come. I'm trying not to force it, I'm trying not to seem desperate to it, the shark, but I need it. I really need a fucking shark right now, and if you're out there, please come to me.
uncharacteristically show me a fin popping out of the water or something, please, and I will go to you. I become suddenly and acutely aware that someone is looking at me, and has been looking at me for some time. Maybe for as long as I've been here. I've been so in my head that it's possible. And I check, just a slight glance to see if someone truly is looking at me, and I am right. I am being watched by a brute. Not muscly, not angry-looking, just a roundish gentleman. But all men have a penis. And hands. Against my general nature and way of being, I go and find a guy who seems strong and honest and honorable to help me. I explain to him the situation, of the man who is leering at me, and I ask if he can pretend to know me for a little while, because I am alone and I feel unsafe. That's the basic gist of what I say. And he is hesitant, probably because I sound like I'm on drugs or something, or because I'm so hot that it seems fishy. And he really wants nothing to do with this. I reek of fish. I am like chum before him. He doesn't want something bad to happen to him. He senses danger, and he thinks it's from me, and what he assumes is a lie or a half-truth that I am telling. But little does he know the danger he is detecting is from the fucking man who I need help with. And fuck, I feel little now. So little and so scared to leave, scared to do anything. I am an 8-year-old and my parents are gone. They left me at the beach. They fucking forgot me. That never happened to me, but I feel it as though it had. Or as though it is happening to me right now, even. I don't know how I'm going to get out of here. I can't move. I'm lost and I'm cold and I can't move. And his eyes are on me. And his fingers are drumming against his wrist. I can feel them as though they are on me. They're unpleasant and cold and clammy. I wake, and wake hard. I look around hard, and my vision is still a bit blurry from sleep. I can't tell, but I'm fairly certain he's not around anymore. I look harder, and my vision returns more, and I am definitely sure he is not around. And I have no idea if he was ever here, or if anyone was ever here. It could all have been just a dream. This beach is a ghost. This beach is not good. Now I know it never goes here, because it's haunted. No one should ever go here. You will have dreams here. Your dreams will be your life, and vice versa. I can't explain it. All I know is that I don't want to die here. I still want to die, but not here. Not like this. Not this way. Never this way. No one should ever die like this. And I get the sense that so many have. Maybe not here exactly, but died somewhere like this place. And that dying in your sleep is just drifting to a realistic, awful dream like the one I just had. Except it never ends. If it is like that, then fuck that fucking shit. Fuck it to hell. Fuck a bed. Kill me on a treadmill. Kill me driving a car. I barely even want to sleep in beds anymore, if that's what it's like. I barely even want to sit on them. Kill me while I'm alive, is all I ask of the world. Kill me while alive. Kill me while I'm swimming. While I'm letting a shark have its way with me with its mouth. Kill me nice and good like that. Nice and good like that. It is a new day. Yesterday was yesterday, but Fort Tilden is today, and it is beautiful. A truly and surprisingly beautiful place. I was told never to come here. I was specifically warned that I'd see penises here. A guy once told me that he came here and saw two penises in a row. Two penises in a row. I don't even know what that means specifically, and he didn't clarify. He just kept repeating it exactly, clearly tickled by his own vagueness. And so I just avoided this place, and put it low on my list of possible beaches to die at. But had I known it was so beautiful here, I might have put it at the top. And I'm sure there's areas of this huge beach where there are penises, in a row, but I've seen none in this spot. It's a fine place to be, this spot of Fort Tilden Beach. A fine place to be. These waves are absolutely gorgeous. I've never seen waves this cool looking. If anything is in a row, it's these waves. Rows and rows of long, white beauty. I could stare at them for forever, if I didn't want to die so much. I could become an elderly woman here, looking out. This water is legitimately life-affirming in a way that most water tries to be, but isn't. Even though I'd rather be dead than alive, I'm honest enough to admit that. There is a man looking at me. I know this for sure. After re-speech yesterday, I've recalibrated myself to once again notice these things well. I was so off that day. Let's not talk about it. The point is, I'm on now. I don't know what he looks like or what he's wearing, but I can feel his eyes, and in my peripherals I can see his blurriness. That's all I need to know that he's there, and that he's a he. Women have a different blurriness in the peripherals than men do. It's hard to explain. It's beyond what words can describe. It's just different. The man comes over to me, because of course he does, and the man turns out to be a boy. He's nervous and he's asking me about shells or something, if I've seen any of a particular type that he's looking for. It's preposterous. He can't possibly have any actual interest in shells. He just wants to talk to me. I go along with it, though, because I want to see how far he goes with it, this fake shell interest. Anyone who can keep something like that going for a long time, some dumb lie, is usually not an actual threat. The wolves, on the other hand, are the ones who move away from the lie and onto some other topic as quickly as possible once they're in. I ask him if he'd like to sit down. I ask him this because I don't want to have to keep staring at his nervous hands in his pockets, and his crotch. I don't tell him that. He keeps talking about shells, even while now sitting next to me. He's so committed to this that I'm probably the most beautiful woman he's ever seen in his life. He would keep on this shells topic until I am his wife, and after. He would speak only of shells even when I am old and in a casket and he's giving some speech mourning me. He would tell my family and loved ones that I loved shells. People would look at each other like, she did? It's kind of endearing how hard he'd commit to this, although I doubt I'll be able to take much more than a few more minutes of this shell talk. Weirdly, I do take it, though. He takes me over to some actual shells, and he starts talking to me about them, and they're actually pretty cool. I can tell what he's saying isn't bullshit, too. He genuinely has some knowledge about this stuff. I don't quite understand how someone can care so much about something so inanimate, so discarded by whatever lived in it or whatever, but he does, and I have to respect that, as a fellow ocean nature lover. It's interesting to be on the other side of this for once. Usually I'm chewing someone's ear off about sharks, I mean. Here I'm not mentioning them at all, just listening to someone else share their passion. It's making me kind of attracted to him, actually, since one of the things that attracts me to myself so much is my own passion. I wonder if I rocked his world on his bed, wherever the hell that is, probably his parents' house or something. I'd feel myself in his touch, like his fingers were mine. That might be nice. If I am to leave this world, I should probably get laid one last time. That's something I hadn't considered before, probably because most people are such people besides me, and who wants that? But this guy is kind of like me, and that could be nice. So rarely do we get to step outside of ourselves, never, really, but this guy might provide some semblance of that. I can just pretend that when he says shells, he has some sort of speech impediment and means sharks. I can pretend that he's narcissistic and suicidal like me. I can meet him halfway, and I can destroy him for life. No woman will ever compare to me, because unbeknownst to him, I will be the closest thing to himself that he will ever encounter in life. I will be like a giant version of his right hand or something, wrapped around him like his whole body is his dick. While he's talking to me about shells or whatever, I notice a girl arrive at the beach. She seems so young and peaceful, so unbroken. Maybe not a virgin, per se, but unhurt by life or man, like a cat that's never been swiped at by another cat. I get all of this from what is probably just a quick glance by me at her while he stares at a shell, talking to me about it. I wish her well in my head and look away from her and don't look back. I wish her well because I know that the well she has been thus far in her life never lasts long. She will be corrupted. Somewhere, someday, maybe even today, maybe even now, she will be spotted by ne'er-do-wells, attracted less to her beauty and more just to her innocence. She is like a fresh baguette that certain men in this world just want to rip apart and feast on, leaving her never to be whole again. I don't mean she'll necessarily be raped, or abused, or anything. I just mean that she'll understand what it's like to be prey, and once you feel that, it never goes away. It's entirely possible that my desire to die by way of a shark eating me is a thing where I want to take control and ownership of my feeling like I'm prey and have it belong to me rather than be something that was inflicted on me. I'm not stupid. I understand psychology and how things arise in a person and whatnot. It's definitely plausible as fuck. The fact that what I have on my chest, and what I have between my legs, and what I have behind my legs is something that men want to the extent that they will sometimes become monsters in order to try and have it has always felt awful to me. That there are guys out there who will just bother and bother you in hopes that you'll just break down and give them a taste. It's horrible. Like most women, I've experienced guys doing that to me since I was in fourth grade or so. And maybe that grated on me particularly hard and caused the shark desire eventually. I don't know. Even if I went to a therapist or a psychiatrist or something, their guess would only be as good as mine. I know how that industry works. And plus, it's not something in me that I want fixed. If it led to me wanting to be eaten by a shark, then I am grateful for it. I am happy like this. It's nice talking to this gentleman. He really is a gentleman, I've decided. And his confidence has grown, but not offensively, and he's steering the conversation to us maybe going somewhere sometime, getting a coffee or a tea or something. And I'm playing the proper role of smiley and eager that guys like to see. And then some fucking lunatics bust in. At first, I think maybe the gentleman knows them, but it becomes clear that they're just behaving as though they do, and he's just behaving as though he's comfortable with them, in hopes that they don't bother us too severely. I don't know what it is about men being bullied where they think if they just pretend to be cool, the ruffians fucking with them will abandon their path of fucking with them and instead become their new friends. It never works. If anything, it angers the ruffians because they're upset that you're not playing your role correctly. They spotted you as a mark, so behave like one. Don't be something you're not and make them feel as though they assessed you wrong. That's insulting. I hate these moments in life where I feel vulnerable and I know that anything could happen. Situations like these are how people get hurt or die, even when the ruffians are just relatively harmless numbskulls who merely want to seem alpha around me, a girl they could never have in a million years, and make the guy I'm giving the time of day seem like a loser. It's funny, because under a different circumstance, like if me and the ruffians worked at the same restaurant or something, they'd be my greatest protectors. They'd be the older brothers I never had. They'd probably get fired and rehired a lot for missing work or smoking weed on the job, but while they were there I'd feel untouchable. However, because we're meeting like this, I am just prey to them. The gentleman is wilting away and is giving me away, practically. It's like he feels like if he acts like he doesn't know me or care about me at all, they'll just leave us alone. And he just goes, like I am nothing. And then I just go too. And it all ends, just like that. I watch the ruffians from afar for quite a while. The smarter one is giving the dumber one shit for being such a dumbass, like it's solely his fault that they blew it with us. It's kind of cute, actually. I can see the love there. I can see that they've been friends for a while, and that they'll be friends forever. I've never had a friend like that, one of those classic friendships that literature is made of, where there's a wiser one and a dumber one. You can't help but watch that shit, or read that shit. That dynamic is timeless. I don't ever want to talk to them again, but I appreciate that they exist. It's almost worth the unending uncomfortability and stress they cause everyone they encounter, because what they have is rare and beautiful. I pack up my stuff, because this wasn't the place. Not a bad place, but I don't want to die near the lingering energy of what just went down. Maybe the penises my friend saw weren't literal, but guys like those two. The virginal one is suddenly talking to me, asking me if those guys bothered me. I tell her yeah. Apparently they bothered her too, which makes sense. I don't know what she wants from me. I tell her that I don't care. And as I walk from her, leaving her in the dust, I realize that my indifference will have done more to end her childhood than those men ever did. I feel momentarily bad and regretful, but whatever. Better that the band-aid got yanked off by a fellow woman, I guess. Rockaway Beach was dead last on my list. If I don't die here today, I'm dead. Just kidding. I'm sure there's other beaches I can find. I basically only wrote down in my head the ones that I could think of off the top of my head. I avoided this one mostly because it's so iconic. I would never be able to be synonymous with it, that's for sure. As beautiful as I am, and as beautiful as my being eaten by a shark would be, I'm not more beautiful than a great punk song. I'm man enough to admit that. Staring at the water here, I more just want other people here to be eaten by a shark and not myself. It's the kind of place where people are so happy-go-lucky that you half expect an anvil to fall on their head or something. Or in this case, you expect a cartoonish CGI shark fin to sail towards them and turn them into flailing arms in red water. As much as I hate the shark exploitation film genre, and its birth of a nation, its triumph of the will, the most despicable shark movie ever made, Jaws, I can't not watch shark movies, and only shark movies. Documentaries, yes, but those only do so much for me. I mostly need the pornography of people getting lucky out there in the water by way of CGI sharks, or animatronic sharks, or puppet sharks, just fucking decimating them. And yes, these films contribute to gross misunderstandings and misconceptions about the greatest animal that has ever lived. But they're also so fucking ridiculous by and large that they're kind of, at the same time, making fun of their own inaccuracy. It's not like with Jaws, which is considered one of the best movies ever made, and is well respected, and is so well known, and is the reason we're now sitting on over 1 billion murdered sharks since it came out. That movie drilled into the minds of generations that sharks are a bloodthirsty enemy. And not just a bloodthirsty enemy, but the bloodthirsty enemy. I hate Steven Spielberg with a passion, and if I were in control of society, he would be rotting in a cell somewhere. When Steven Spielberg dies one day, I hope that he goes up to heaven, and God is a shark, and God sends him right down to hell. Sharks are so much like us that it's not too much of a stretch to think that sharks might have been made more in God's image than we were. It's really a coin flip between us. Maybe not, but I like to think it is. The thought that God looks anything like me makes my beauty feel less impressive. I want to be a complete and total aberration in my undeniable gorgeousness. I want my beauty to be a problem for those who are full of faith. I don't know if I should go out into the Rockaway Beach water. I don't feel anything out there, and I also don't feel anything inside of me right now. I don't want to feel empty when I die. I want to feel full of purpose, even if that purpose is just to die. I don't feel my suicidal thoughts and gory desires waning in general or anything. I just feel like I'm not experiencing any sort of sign, and that's making me feel numb. It's demoralizing to be as great as I am and have nothing to show for it yet, even though, of course, things take time. I just want to know that I'm on the right track, though. I want to see a light at the end of the tunnel. An Asian man is coming and talking to me. He is wearing a tiny Speedo and he has a Velcro paddleball catch game. He's never used it before and he wants to know if I'd like to try it out and play it with him. He genuinely wants to do that. It's not a pickup line or an icebreaker or anything. I can tell he's exactly what he seems. It's almost childlike, except he very clearly isn't intellectually disabled or anything. He's a grown man of above average intelligence and he speaks well. There's no language barrier or anything, by the way. He's asking me this in perfect English. He is one of the most undeniably genuine human beings I have ever met, and so I can't say no. I feel butterflies within me at the rareness of him, and I can't help but go and play. I've never played with this toy before, either. I've seen people play with it, but I never had it as a kid, and I don't remember any friends of mine having it. It's pretty cool. It basically makes it so you can catch the ball easily, even if you can't catch, because the fuzzy Velcro ball just sticks to the rough Velcro paddle. And the ball is easy to throw, and it's fun to pull the ball off the paddle once it's stuck. You have to really yank it, because it's Velcro, and it makes a nice sound. I recommend this toy to anyone of all ages. The toy reinvigorated me. I've heard that doing something you don't normally do can give your brain a rest from thinking about what it's thinking about, and then you're able to think about it more clearly when you do start thinking about it again. Well, it did do that, and sitting and looking out at the water with him, completely peacefully, completely platonically, I feel like myself again. I feel able to accomplish my goal. I've never met a more incredible man in my life than this man. He wants absolutely nothing from me other than to play Velcro catch with me and look out at the water with me. I even love his little Speedo. It's badass. He is the ideal beachgoer and the ideal companion for me, and I will never see him again after today. I don't mean that I will die today. This is definitely not the place. I just mean that after this moment of looking out at the water is over, we will part ways. I will make sure of it. He's too good for me. I cannot give him anything he truly deserves in life. He needs a wife, and children, and grandchildren, that whole thing. And it's what he should have. He doesn't need a friend that he loves and would do anything for, and then one day I'm just gone and dead by a shark. He needs to know practically no one who has died from anything other than old age. That is what he truly deserves as such a sweet man. The realm of sad girls should be totally unknown to him. Drop-dead gorgeous women like me who want to drop dead. He should not know we exist, whether our poison is wanting to be eaten by a shark, or razor blades, or pills, or literal poison. For him to truly see my soul would corrupt him in some way, would fill him with doubt about women and the world, and he doesn't deserve that. No one does. We're the spoil sports of the world. We are God's greatest humans, and also its greatest destructors. So beautiful and intelligent that fuck it all. It's not really a beach. It's just kind of a rocky spot to stare across the East River at Manhattan from Brooklyn. People come here as a tourist thing, apparently. I had no idea it was a thing. I'm standing by the big rocks, where the tourists don't really stand for some reason. It seems they like to stand by the pebbles instead. I don't blame them. The pebbles are cool looking, and they're why the spot is called Pebble Beach, I figure. I might check them out, but I'm over here with the big ones instead for now, just vibing out. There's no way there will be a shark here today, but I'm daydreaming hard and poetically descriptively about my death, to maybe attract one for another day. I believe that sharks can hear the frequency of my horrific thoughts. It's like my legs are open wide and my pheromones are floating out, but for shark death. I saw a documentary once where they showed footage of a guy getting his leg chewed up by a bull shark. The shark only bit a couple times, but his leg was shredded after. His leg skin looked like fettuccine hanging off a serving spoon, just dangling and ribbony and soaked with marinara. Every time I eat pasta, I think about it. I eat pasta a lot. It's my favorite. I'm thinking about his leg, and I'm manifesting that it will be my leg. I want it to be all my legs and all my arms. I want it to look from afar like I am a being with dozens of skinny arms and legs. And then, when you swim closer, you see that it's all just shredded skin dangling off of me as a result of shark bites. My musculature naked underneath, exposed and not sure what to do. My musculature feeling self-conscious, maybe, as I fucking die. Over at the pebbles, I'm thinking about how my organs will look like sea creatures as they are freed from my body and into the water from certain powerful bites. So much inside of us that keeps us going just looks like weird sea creatures when you think about it. We are like an assemblage of them, an ocean unto ourselves. I want to see them blobby and floating in the seawater, no clue how to swim, no way to live out in the blue. My liver or my kidney making damn near eye contact with me, perhaps, and looking confused. As beautiful as I am, and as beautiful as my body is, I kind of just want to be blood. I want to be a red cloud in water, as my body drifts lifelessly away from it, like the blood is my soul or something. That's kind of the appeal of a classic razor blade bathtub suicide. But shark teeth are like razor blades. Or rather, razor blades are like shark teeth. So why not just have the real organic thing? A woman has come up next to me now and is striking up conversation. She has pegged me as an attractive woman. My secret is out, I have been found out. Whenever I get hit on, it's like they think they're the first to have eyes before. And when it's women, it's like they think they're so fucking perceptive because they could tell from afar that I like women sometimes. Big fucking whoop. She's so dominant that it's kind of off-putting. Everything about her outfit and her whole body language, it's like she wants to control me and thinks of me as someone who either enjoys that or needs that. It's like she finds me beautiful in a way where I'm just beautiful. Just a trophy or something. Well, if I am a trophy, I'm the kind of trophy that is used as a weapon in the heat of domestic violence, crashed against and into someone's skull. The marble base embedded in the brain blood rushing past it like people running out of a store where someone has started shooting people. These are the kinds of things that go on in my head that she will never know. And she's definitely the kind of person that stares and smiles and says, "I wish I knew what was going on in that head of yours." I could kill people who do that. I sit with her a bit after she asks if I want to sit with her, because I'm going to fucking kill her. She doesn't know it yet, but she will die today. And as I sit, I can't help but think about all the women she's had, all the women that have put up with her strength and domineeringness. It's like I'm next to an abuser, though I'm sure she's never hurt a hair on anyone's head. I'm sure plenty of ex-lovers hate her guts, though. I'm sure instead of ashes, they would like a glass jar of her guts after she dies, so they can throw it against a brick wall in an alley of their choice. This woman that I do not know, and know nothing about, hurts people, and she is touching my leg like it belongs to her, like so many women have belonged to her. Oh man, am I going to end her. Oh man, am I going to do what they would not or could not do. Walking away is murder. You can kill someone just by getting up and walking away. Nothing could be more murderous than allowing someone to live. Death would be an escape from feeling what she's feeling right now. What was to be a done deal conquest for her has become someone who felt her soul and rejected it, didn't want what she was offering cosmically. She will act like it doesn't bother her, but it bothers her. However hot she thought I was, I am even hotter to her now for rejecting her, which makes the burn even more intense. Her mind is rushing away from worries about her soul to worries about being not as physically attractive as she thought she was. She feels uncomfortable in her own skin. She wonders if she's getting older, if she's already had the most attractive women she will ever have, her beauty now fading. In truth, she's fucking gorgeous, but she doesn't deserve to know that. She deserves to be knocked down a peg or two, to be forced to become less of a smooth operator, to have to treat strangers she wants to fuck better, decently, even. She just found out her happiest and most abusive days are over, like she's in jail now and can't harm innocence anymore. Tell me a literal knife to the heart and then darkness forever is worse than that, because it's fucking not. I stick around Pebble Beach for a while to let it really sink in her. She doesn't glance at me at all, but I know she knows I'm still here, alone, no her next to me. I am on the big rocks and I am mighty. I have the high ground. I feel like a beast up here in a beautiful way. I feel like a lion or some sort of cat like that. Even a house cat if it has the right attitude. And my thoughts drift back to gore. I think about Sarah's fluid, that clearish stuff you sometimes bleed sometimes. I bet some of that will escape me into the water from the massive shark bites. And as time stands still, as motion goes slow, I will look for it, shimmering in the water like a ghost. My eyes will distinguish it from the water, it having a slightly different consistency, probably. It will be the last thing I see before I am taken somewhere far elsewhere, the farthest elsewhere place there is. This place is fucking nothing. In the picture online it looked like a beach, but really it's just a sandbox. It's just a spot in Brooklyn Bridge Park if you want to feed ducks or whatever, I guess. Actually, you probably can't even feed them. I bet they even crack down on that. You probably can just look at them and wish you were them. Anything but a human standing on a disappointing not a beach. To say that I will not be eaten by a shark here is an understatement. I will so not be eaten by a shark here that it's far more likely I would eat a shark here myself, and I would never do that. And I'm demoralized because this is the last beach I could find. There are a couple private beaches in Brooklyn that I just get kicked off of. Yes, even beautiful me, but that's about it. All I have left is this place, and this place is a bust. This place is a giant fucking breast. This place is a giant statue from the shoulders up. I am fucked. So much for dying in Brooklyn. Being born in Brooklyn, I wanted to die in Brooklyn, but that might not be in the cards. I ask some old fucker if this is the whole beach part of this area. He is old and seems like he's been around forever and would know. He starts rambling in an old way about this spot. Nobody cares, old man. I ask him if he knows of any obscure beaches. He wants to know why, and I tell him that I'm looking for sharks. This tickles him. I just tickled an old man with what he thought was a witty retort. And now he's talking about sharks and talking about Jaws. I pretend not to think that movie is the fucking devil, so that the conversation continues, because I sense that he does know of an obscure beach, and it turns out he does. He says his favorite beach is Plum Beach, Plum with a B at the end. He is describing it and how to get there. I don't even fully believe it exists, but he says it does, and that it's in Brooklyn, and he describes more or less where it is, and it sounds plausible. I will have to look it up later, but it sounds plausible. As thanks for the information, I sit and talk with him for a while and be a nice young woman. He probably hasn't sat and talked to a nice young woman in ages. I am engaging and gregarious and intelligent with him. I am restoring of one's faith in young people. He talks about shark movies, and his knowledge is so limited and cursory, but I indulge him and act fascinated to learn that there are sequels to Jaws. He even says that Jaws 4 is terrible, which is a fucking lie. That movie is the shit. I love that fucking movie. The first Jaws is fascist evil horse shit, but that fourth one is wonderful. I don't say that, though. We keep talking for a while. I make his day, basically. His week, his month, maybe his year. Who knows how long he will live. but he strikes me as someone who likes living. I have to respect that. It's a different philosophy than my own, but he's nice, and I should respect others' beliefs. I personally want to die, but that's just me. That's my belief, for me to have and for everyone else to never fucking know. Thank you, old man, for the tip about Plum Beach, if such a place even exists. You will envision me loving it there, and me going back to it a lot throughout a very long life that I will lead. In truth, though, if it's half as great a place as you say, I will be dead tomorrow. This place is fucking amazing. The old man was right. The old man was right. Holy shit. Holy fucking shit. What a full of life spot. The blue sky, the white clouds, the shimmering diamond fucking water. I see the seaweed and I just want to shove it in my mouth. I want to wet it with seawater and rub it all over my fucking body. It's probably good for me. Why wouldn't it be? It's here. And here is fucking great. Even the people here are fucking amazing. Good American people. Small and in the distance. A good American flag standing strong and proud here. Small and in the distance. Land of the free. Land of me freeing my body of me. Land of death. Land where I will die. And the babes here. Oh lord, the babes. Babes you could eat off of. Babes that should be plates. Babes that I swear to fucking God. I've only seen two babes so far, but two is all you need. With babes these good, who needs more babes? No one. Fucking no one. My mouth is watering like I'm thinking about pickles, but I'm just ogling these babes. Leering, creeping, knowing hot in my mouth that I will befriend them, and they will love me, adore me, think I'm the coolest thing since pajamas that belong to a cat. I stare at the water and know that it is a gravesite that will belong to me. I will die here. I will fucking die here. It even looks like me. This beach is so beautiful. I swear to God I could look into a mirror fully naked and see this beach staring back at me. This place is a coffin carved to my exact form. And no one knows it exists, and no one knows I exist, even though we're such perfect beings. How are we not destinations? Well, we will be. When I spectacularly die here, we will be. I will lean into each and every bite. I will accept them like no one has ever accepted pain and gore before. My body will be absolutely demolished, chunks gone everywhere you look. Vast caverns lined with raspberry jam through which to see any area of me inside and out. I go over to the babes and ask if they've seen any sharks. They are instantly charmed by my eagerness and tone. No fear in me, like I'm just looking for dolphins or something. I have them through my uniqueness, my quirkiness, mixed with my gorgeousness. I am instantly a woman to know, and to want to be known by. They play along with my fearlessness, and exhibit a bit of it themselves, acting like this is a universe where sharks are not to be afraid of. That is, of course, this actual universe, unbeknownst to them, but whatever. It's nice that I can be myself with them, and they will interpret it as a woman with just a cool, funny, ironic angle on life. Even if I pepper in my darkness, they will be okay with it. They may even welcome it. I have them in a comfy seat watching me. If I were a movie, they would watch the whole fucking thing. I ask them if they want to look for sharks with me, and they of course say yes. In truth, I am fishing with them. They are my bait. I am bait too, but three meals are more enticing than one. Breakfast, lunch, and dinner, all at once. All breasts and rumps and legs, plus faces you could look at for the rest of your life and never cheat on. Us each is perfect meat, three different genres of meat, but it will eat only me. I explain to them how it is actually possible for a shark to come here, and how and why geographically such an area might be attractive to a lone one exploring. I dispel the fin myth about it poking out of the water as it swims, and all that stuff. I display myself to be a very knowledgeable woman, and well-rounded, an expert as well as an entertaining personality. I am someone they would watch online. I would captivate them through their phone or laptop. It is like they are my students. It's great. It is like I have two teacher's pets, and they are also my two favorite girls in the whole school, and I am informing their concept of how great a woman can be in life and what they should strive to be. Fuck the textbooks, the tests, the boys, the exams, the everything. My presence in their life is all that matters. All else of school should be flushed down the toilet in order to overflow it and make the janitor have to clean it up. I run this bitch, and they are my bitches in training. That is what it feels like, as I tell them about shark fin soup and all the shit with that. Bitches love hearing about shit like that. Bitches love knowing about fucked up shit that they can rally against. After I am gone, dead, kaput, they will maybe fight the good fight and spread the word about injustice, and hopefully end that and many other unconscionable things we do to the ocean and its inhabitants. It's a beautiful ocean. It's a beautiful world, really, because the ocean is the world. Sometimes I get sad about the idea of leaving it, but then I remember that I am not leaving it. I am truly entering it. Life is just the surface land, and death is really the ocean. Who knows how much of that place humans have truly explored? probably nothing. I know that if I get there, and that's the case there, I will chart the nothingness, chart the blackness, and explore it fully and deeply. I am so good at exploring my own darkness here that I just know that I would be great at exploring the darkness there. Maybe the suicidal living become the explorers of there. I'd like to think that we go to good use and are not just tossed away to a pit of fiery pain and suffering. My words have changed them. Back at their area, after the conversation, they are more badass, more empowered as women. The ocean returns to us a power taken from us. Every new thing we learn about it makes the water inside of us stronger water. I believe this with every fabric of my liquid being. Being so outwardly awesome, so on, can take it out of me. I rest a little in the lovely sunlight, nothing moving of me except my chest going up and down ever so slightly. There are perks to being a human, I won't deny it, and this is one of the best of them. Sharks cannot rest like this. They have no eyelids, they never not see. They don't even know what it is not to. All they know is ocean forever. Brilliantly gray ocean. They can't even see color. If I couldn't see color, I'd probably kill myself. I'm going to kill myself anyway, but you know what I mean. Sharks don't know the difference, though. Color will never be explained to them, and besides, they probably see in a way far beyond our concept of color, or black and white. I find it hard to believe they see blood and just see darkness. Blood probably looks like the most beautiful color imaginable to them, far outside our spectrum of comprehension. I don't know. Maybe. I'm speculating, I'm guessing. It's hard for me to think right now. There are new people here now that I can sense the presence of near my bitches. Friends of theirs, presumably. And I don't want to look over and see what they look like. I just want to die, and them all be audience to it. I'm standing in front of them all now, and they have no interest in me. I look amazing, I am captivating, and yet they are in their own world. I can taste the visuals of myself, almost, and I know that I'm delicious. I glance ever so slightly back at them, not enough to even see them at all, just enough to perceive them. They don't enter my peripherals, but their souls do, and my bitches' souls feel devoid of me. I trust that I will return to their souls in time, though. If not later today, then at some point later in their life. They will feel my power in them again one day. I leave my sunglasses with my stuff and head to the water. The sand is surprisingly hot, in spots at least, and the water is surprisingly cold in spots. This place is so full of life that nothing is just one thing. Dice are rolling all over the place. This place, on an energetic level, is the beauty of chaos. I get as much of my energy into the water as possible, wading around, swimming around. I want to be a constant here. I want to be something a shark can lock onto from afar like a beacon, a sexy buoy, a soulmate. No such luck with that, though. I am too new to this place. I can't even crack its surface. It has too established a vibe. The bitches actually have the right idea. You just gotta be here, calmly, doing beach things, so it can warm up to you and accept your vibe into its own. They are establishing more of themselves here than I am. And they're just people being people. This chick has breasts and a sandwich, and she's fucking rocking it right now. This other chick has just her arms and her legs, and she's fucking rocking it too. The seas are open to them, and the seas are closed to me. I towel this water off of me, water I don't even deserve yet, I announce silently, wordlessly. A little bit of humbleness can go a long way. The universe of Plum Beach will respect that someone who thinks as highly of themselves as I do is willing to play ball and start again on its terms. Nature forgives. I will repent. I bow my head and use my phone, like normal people do. I ignore the people next to me, like normal people do. There is a lady in a watermelon bikini and a goofy baseball cap right next to me with glasses. Some hipster lady or something. I refuse to form any real thoughts about her, though. Nor about the nothing man just past her. These are the friends of my bitches that came to visit them. The nothing man is just napping, doing whatever. I will not judge him, or anyone, or anything here, because the beach is absorbing them. And if I respect that, it will absorb me, too. It has to. I am playing by its rules. I am following and not leading. For a time, at least. The light is loving the bitch in blue, and she has no idea or care. She's just on her phone, doing phone stuff. The light is loving me, too. And my mind is off except for very bare, simple thoughts. I am being as much of a normal, simpleton being as possible, and the light is caressing me, and the sand fits like a chair. I feel almost like I'm in a bath. My toes are loving it. And I don't yes-and any of this and wax poetic. I stay surface. I do not start thinking about baths and what they mean to me. I do not get overly analytically beautiful about shit. I don't think about how good the blondish one looks as the day is thinking about ending and the clouds are getting more colorful in spots. And the light stays on these bitches for a little while, and they bask in it. But eventually it leaves them. It does not leave me, though. The light has made a choice, and it has chosen right. The light is caressing me like a million beds. I am a beautiful babe on the beach, a beautiful babe that belongs here, and the light knows that now. And when I get up and stand and look at the water, it is as though it is earlier in the day still. You would never know that the sun will be setting in an hour or two. That is because it doesn't want to. It wants to stay here with me, The sun is the messenger of this place, and it has told me that this place approves of me, and I will return here tomorrow, and it will be so happy to see me that it will grant me any wish I want so long as I promise to stay here forever. How perfect, because my wish involves staying here forever, as a woman never to be forgotten from this place. The greatest shark death in the history of the world, real or fiction, will take place here at Plum Beach. My name is Chase, and my dream is to be eaten by a shark, and tomorrow I will finally find what I've been looking for. I woke up this morning and decided to change things up a bit. Maybe the lavender bikini was bad luck, the common denominator across all these no-shark days in need of changing, so I dug this sporty one-piece out of the back of my closet. The weather decided to change things up a bit, too. It's quite overcast today.
My name is Brandy, and my dream is to be eaten by a shark. I don't even know who I'm talking to, but I feel like my thoughts need to be recorded somewhere before I die. Even if that recording is just my brain, I can never put pen to paper or thumbs to screen about this desire. That would be too embarrassing to leave behind. And I could never tell it to anyone with my voice. No one would relate. No one would understand. So I will just have to think this, which is fine. Whatever. This beach is pretty. I like how golden and yet depressing it feels. It's so overcast, yet the water still shimmers. That's cool. I bet sharks come here to take in the beauty. Even if they don't, I bet they do. I don't really know what to say. I don't know what I should talk about, or if I should try and explain or justify my desire or something. If I have to, then I guess it starts with the fact that I always feel like I could be more. I feel like I'm almost beautiful. So close. Yet, something's missing. Well, I think what's missing is death. There's a saying that goes, leave a pretty corpse. I forget where I first heard it, but it always stuck with me. I would much rather be dead from shark bites in my prime than be an old, gray woman. And I feel like the gore would distract from the fact that I'm not perfectly beautiful. People would see my corpse and think that the world lost a true, great beauty. A 10, and not the mere 9 that I am. There is a cute boy a bit further down the beach. He has a weird tan. Dark legs from the knees down, with white feet. And just a slight farmer tan up top. It's funny and cute. I walk in a kind of arc so that I'm not walking straight at him. And I come and talk to him. I ask him if he's seen any sharks. His face catches me off guard because he's a lot more attractive than I was prepared for. He says he hasn't seen any sharks. And then we just keep talking. I tell him that I like sharks. I feel awkward, like I'm exposing some nude, unsexy part of myself by saying that. But he's really nice. He doesn't pick on me about it or anything, like some guys would. I hate when guys try and get you to like them by being mean to you. He's not doing that. He's just being genuine and kind. He's really interested and wants to know more. So I tell him about how much I liked him and why. He's really easy to talk to. We sit down and just talk for a while. He has a very soft and calm voice. He seems like a sensitive soul to me. Like he might understand where I'm coming from and respect my mind. So I start telling him how it's my dream to be eaten by a shark. And how cool it would be. He kind of agrees a little. Or at least he sees the benefit of it. Like why it would be a badass way to go. I think he thinks I'm joking around. But whatever. It feels good to be able to tell someone my desire, to put it out into the open, even if it will be seen as just me being ironic and random, maybe. I don't know. It's nice that we kind of just have the beach to ourselves, this boy and I. I feel like I can tell him anything, like we're private somewhere and no one can hear us. I would never tell him about my own imperfect beauty being the reason I want to be eaten by a shark. That would be far too naked of me. Plus, he'd feel an obligation to give me all sorts of compliments or something, like it's compliments that I'm lacking. And not confidence and comfortability in my own skin. I get that I'm dysmorphic or whatever, probably. I know how to look stuff up on the internet and learn what things are called and whatnot. I also get that I'm probably just an awkward teenager, but I'm almost not a teenager. I'm in my last year of being one. I should be over this by now. I should be starting to feel like a grown woman. I should not be feeling like my body is just some weird suit I'm wearing. It should feel like something I have ownership of. And have had ownership of for 19 years. Instead, it's always felt like a car I'm in that doesn't belong to me. That's really what it comes down to, I think. I don't even feel like my death is even a big deal, because it really doesn't feel like it's my body. I feel like I'm just a soul sitting in a bag of bones and skin and women parts. It's easy to get rid of something if it doesn't belong to you. I don't talk about this with him. We're just talking about golf or islands or something. I'm not even paying attention. I'm in my own head. Recording myself to no recorder at all. Maybe in the future they'll be able to take a brain and scan it and read it. But that's not anytime soon, probably. Oh well. I love that sharks are all teeth and destruction. All they do is bite and bite. We have so many ways to communicate and understand things as humans, but all they have are their own teeth. That's really cool. I heard on TV once that sharks will do what's called exploratory bites. That means they have to bite something in order to figure out what it is and get a sense of it. All they know is biting. It's so funny. It's adorable. Sharks are adorable. I don't care. I know they're scary, but they're hot scary. They're like beautiful women or something, because nobody can destroy you like a beautiful woman can. That's something I'll miss getting a chance to do. Really destroy someone. I've hurt some boys in middle school and high school, but just with like surface stuff, exploratory bites. But grown women can really hurt men, take all of their money in a big divorce or something, take the kids. That's so amazing. I don't even think that I would want to do any of that, but I like the fact that I can. I like that it's teeth that I have as a woman. It's crazy how the ocean is just full of millions of sharks, and yet nobody thinks about it. They're everywhere, and they just eat fish and stuff. They rarely eat humans. Did you know that? It's super rare. But I think it'll happen to me. I watch shark movies all the time, and I know they're not real, but I look like one of those girls who would die in a shark movie, I think. Like the woman in the beginning of Jaws or something. My favorite movie. The best movie ever made. I think a lot of life is just seeing what you kind of look like and going for that in life. If you look like a teacher, you become a teacher. If you look like a porn star, you become a porn star. I look like some blonde who would die in a shark movie. That's my logic about it, kind of. But also, it's just something I genuinely want and would want no matter what. I do think the look helps, though. I think it means that it's meant to happen to me, whereas it doesn't happen to so many people. So many people go their entire lives not being eaten by a shark. Almost everyone. Maybe some of them even want to be eaten by a shark like I do, but just can't make it happen for some reason. Just can't swing it. I could swing it though, like a golf club. I think he's talking about golf clubs now. Eventually he goes and I am alone. I think he got bored of me and decided I didn't have much to me. That's how most of my conversations end, even though I feel like I have a lot to me. I don't always show it though, probably. I'm still young. I know that's no excuse, but I'm still young. The beach is more empty now, and the skies have parted a bit, and the sun is shining nicely on me. I wish someone would take a photograph of me right now. I know that I look good. I know that I look like I should, like blondes are meant to. When I'm in light like this, I might even be a 9.5, and not just a measly 9. I'd chill by the water for a little bit, but the water is cold. I don't really want to go in it and die right now. I want warmer water to die in. I want it to be like a warm bath. I know the ocean is not like that, but still, it's what I would like. Some version of that. I'll just come back here tomorrow. No shame in not reaching my goal on my very first day. It's my plan to just keep coming back to this beach until the day my dream does come true, and I die the way I want, with some shark ripping me apart. Maybe it sounds stupid, coming back over and over, but it makes sense to me. I've got nothing else to do anyway, and life is a dice roll anyway. I like my Vegas shirt. It reminds me of that. I will roll the dice again tomorrow. I used to come to this beach when I was a kid, apparently. My parents used to take me, but I don't really remember it. Or my parents. I mean from back then. I look at photographs of them from back then, and they look nothing like the people I see every day now. We live in a nice house and everything, and they tell me we used to not, but I don't remember that. They're so together and have so much money. It seems impossible that they ever didn't. But they always say, we were really lucky. Just like that. We were really lucky. No information. I don't know what they mean. I don't understand their jobs or anything, or what happened. But maybe if they were lucky, I will be lucky too.
She's here again. I thought she was just a nightmare, a one-time scare I could be done with and forget forever, but no, she's here again. What even is she? Is she a mirror? She is not a mirror. She can't be how I seem to people. If she is how I seem to people, how I come across, I will kill myself right now, and not in a fun, shark way either. What is my existence right now? Am I being mocked? Why am I a Veronica to a Betty? Why is there a Betty to my Veronica? What the fuck is going on? Are there more of her? Am I but one of myriad women who want to go out this way, like some sort of mass hysteria has taken hold? I doubt it. I think it's just me and this bitch who is suddenly here and playing my slot machine, too. Granted, she doesn't know what she's doing, whose turf she's come in on. I have that over her, as upper hand. I know reality and she doesn't. I have the first move. I study the player across the table who is not studying me, not looking my direction at all. She is in her own little world, looking for a shark to die by in her own little way. She can't be a toe older than 18. I can buy a beer and she can't. I can buy a beer can and bash her fucking skull in. Silly cunt thinks she can cut in line. This is a woman's game, and she's a tyke on a fucking trike. I will own you, little girl. Your parents should have driven you here today. They should be next to you right now, eating potato salad. When I'm through with you, you'll wish they were. I come over and make conversation. I tell her that I saw her here yesterday, and that I think I overheard her say she likes sharks. She confirms that she does. I tell her that I like sharks too, and I ask her if I heard her right yesterday that she wants to be eaten by a shark, because I do too. She instantly feels as though she has made a new friend. This isn't friendship, little one, but you're too young to know that yet. She's beaming so big and bright, and I beam back. She feels safe, but she's not safe. She's in my hand. We banter about sharks, and being eaten by sharks, and all that. She's actually surprisingly knowledgeable. She's put some thought into sharks, and into being eaten by one. I see myself in her, but I don't see her in myself, if that makes sense. She brings me back, though. I forgot what it's like to have girl time, to just shoot the shit with no regard for how fucking young you sound doing it, how high your voices get or how stupid your inflections get. They say that children make the old young again. Well, she is definitely a child, and definitely makes me feel old by comparison, but she makes me feel childlike at the same time. Warming her up to me is not entirely unenjoyable. We get off sharks and onto just things in general, various subjects. I am learning names of people she knows and forming mental pictures. She is still at that stage in life where most of her friends are just high school holdovers. They've clearly not had that big parting of ways that always eventually occurs. She is still there in those halls, in those classes, like a ghost, going through the motions of relationship drama as distraction from studies without realizing she doesn't need that anymore and can just grow up. I don't tell her that, though. I just listen. I'd be the ideal of a slightly older sister, one you don't fight with and who has simply seen a little more of life than you and as such is a bit more mature and confident. I'm filling a gap in her life, a chasm in her heart. She's probably an only child. I am probably the coolest woman she has ever talked to. This is probably one of the best days of her life. I try and get her in the water with me to try and be eaten by a shark together. I try and sell her on how fun and silly it'll be, but she's scared of the water. She says it looks too cold. I keep selling. In my head, I figure if I can just get her out there, our signal will be like 10 bars combined, and a shark will shoot towards us, and I can just push her out of the way and get all of the death for myself. Really sate the fucker such that he has no interest in her and just bails after. Then she'll be stuck staring at a bloody, ripped-apart me who has just received everything she ever thought she wanted, and she'll realize that she never really wanted it, and she will never try to be eaten by a shark ever again. It will be my thing, mine alone. A great plan, if she weren't such a pussy about cold water. It's all psychological, though. I will warm her. I take off my fucking clothes. That'll warm her up. Not that she's a lesbian or anything, just that I'm beautiful. I feel her eyes on me in awe and appreciation like she's at a museum and is finally seeing a work of art that speaks to her, truly and deeply. A beautiful woman's body can do that to a person. They don't teach you that in school, even art school. Next is her clothes off. I knew that she would follow suit. Girls her age, you don't even have to ask if they want to do things. You just announce to the world what you want to do, and be someone that they respect, even a stranger, and they just follow along and do it too. All I had to do was say that I wanted to lay out in the sun, overcast be damned, and now she's gonna do it too. I should have taken that same approach with the going in the water thing, but alas, I'll get her there. One step at a time. Side by side, you'd think we'd known each other forever. That's how fast you can work. That's how fast these girls can be had. Stranger danger is wasted on the really young. It's girls that are this girl's age that really need it. Little kids are perceptive, whereas by the time girls are out of the K-12 school system, any perception they once had has been beaten out of them and replaced with what button on the big calculator to press for sine, cosine, or tangent, which she's probably already forgotten. She's really quite an angelic, fluttery thing, and I can hear her breaths, and I can feel them too. I can tell that she's never really done this before, never really laid out and relaxed. Maybe she has on her bed, alone, but this is new for her. She's never been a woman, with another woman, on a beach, laying the fuck out. This is adulthood, and she's probably scared she's not doing it right. These are person muscles she's never had to work before. It's a lot, having to feel her energy next to me right now. It's making me not be able to fully enjoy laying on a beach. I wonder if this is what being a parent is like. I put an end to the laying out, eventually, not being able to take her laying out vibe anymore, and suggest a walk along the shore. I spot someone I don't know, plus the girl at the beach yesterday in the watermelon bikini and hat and glasses, except now she's in a black one piece and has no hat on and has her glasses on her head. She remembers me and is happy to see me, and happy to see that I'm friendly. She probably thought I was quiet and a cunt yesterday, because we didn't have a conversation. Now she knows that I'm a person, and an eloquent one to boot, and is palpably excited about that. And now we are a foursome on the beach. At their towel, the one who wasn't there yesterday shows us her cool old camera. She explains analog photography to us, which even in my genius, I don't know much about. I like her voice and I like her enthusiasm. I like her breasts and I like that she exists. But today is more important than her. That doesn't mean I can't have a little fun, though. Something to remember it all by. I am not made of stone. I enjoy objects. I am sentimental. And with my arm around the blonde, I suddenly appreciate the life in her on a tactile level I am not ready for. The blood through her veins, the tiny hairs on her body, the animation of her. I am glad that she and I will be preserved together forever as a flat little square somewhere. After that, the foursome just kind of comes to an end. Maybe on some level it just doesn't feel like we have anything left to do together. The bond was so centered around the camera, and we used it, and film is finite. And so the camera girl goes for a dip. I hope the blonde sees this, and she does. I hope the seeing manifests the desire in her to do the same. It's just a quick dip, but maybe it'll do the trick. Toweling off afterward, the camera girl looks invigorated, which should help sell it. She looks glad to have done it, and doesn't look too cold. And it doesn't hurt that she looks like someone you could spend the rest of your life with. Just the delightful creature of a woman worth making a wife and impregnating and loving forever. I hope that the blonde isn't too young for such persuasion as that to be effective on her. They're such good friends, the two of them, these two strangers. I wonder why the camera girl wasn't there yesterday. I wonder where the nothing man is from yesterday, and if the ex-watermelon-wearing one and him are an item. And if so, why he's not here today. I'm curious about all these things and more about them. I'm curious like a person about to die. I just want more information. Any information. Anything that will keep me feeling like I'm still here. People are such fractals, and peeling back the layers of onions is a big part of being alive. I'm very nervous, and I'm kind of shaking on the inside. I'd think that I'm scared to die, but really I think it's just getting a lot colder here. The two friends, very cold, leave. If all goes right, I will never see them again, which is a sad thought. My lower lip trembles, which I'd think was from that, but really I think it's just getting a lot colder here. I sell and I sell. I am as naked as can be, and as cold as can be. She has all her stuff on now, and we're by far the last ones still at the beach. Today was not a beach day, weather-wise. Today was doomed from the get-go, probably. But I have a newfound responsibility for my own fate rising out of me like goose pimples. I will not accept another failure of a day as though it is something beyond my control. That is who I am now. My patience is gone. And I am just a woman looking a girl in the eyes, pleading with her like a boy looking a girl in the eyes. I want to show her something magical. I want to make the impossible possible. I get her bikinied and out there. I ask her if I can show her something. She asks what. I dip under the water and eat her stomach exactly as a shark would. I know exactly how sharks bite, and so I bit her so many times, chewing and chewing to make the shapes exactly right. I made a perfect copy of shark bites with my mouth. They think that it was a Caribbean reef shark, one that must have been released by someone who had one illegally or whatever, and who probably abused it, leading to its hyper-aggression. Those sharks had the exact same bite force as a human being, so it wasn't that hard to do my bites exactly like one. Plus, bite analysis is pretty fucking stone-aged. Humans have gone to death row accused of bites that were later discovered to be animal bites. It's fun to covertly watch strangers tell other strangers about what happened. There's always some random person who hasn't heard. I don't know how many days exactly it's been since I killed her. Maybe weeks or months. It looks as though the black onesie girl's with a different guy now, if she was ever actually with the nothing man before. The shark I had been looking for was inside of me all along. I know that now. I was chasing myself. Myself at my very best. It's truly a work of art. A masterpiece, what I did. It's one thing to fool the local news, and locals, and cops, but to fool scientists on top of that feels fucking amazing. What more proof do you need that I am as great as I say I am? Her name was Brandy, apparently. That's what the news said. Brandy with a D-I-E, and not a Y. I'm sorry, but anyone with die in their name, it shouldn't be a surprise when they do. You can't fault me over anything that faded. In a perfect world, no court in the land would convict. Sometimes, laying in bed at night, I worry that I didn't actually fool anyone, that they know it was no shark, and that they just want the word out there that it was while they hunt for the real, human perpetrator. If that's the case, and they do find out it was me one day, I'm fine with that. Sharks only live to about 20 or 30 years old in the wild anyway, so why should I live in the wild any longer? I will simply go to jail, and my life will be over as I know it. When I am one day old and gray on my deathbed, whether it be a prison bed or a real one, I will be glad that I am finally gray like a shark. And I will be glad that once, when I was in my prime, I made a girl's impossible wish come true. Most of all, though, I will be glad that I created great art that no one will ever know exists at all. If they catch me, I will admit to the crime, but I will never explain the beauty of what I did to anyone. That, like every word inside of me, is for me and only me.
started alone. You got no one. Started alone. You got no life, and it's hard to follow a simple plan. Remaining alone until the a secret that we multiply when we convulse and die. Elevator, catch you later on the lowest floor. Darken the coldest door. You're an elderly tramp, comedian with zero fan base. You're a psychopath with a heart of stone. And these lies you tell our daughters are now tantamount to rape. Remaining alone, your escape. Filled with regret, something so secret and die. Elevator, catch you later on the lowest floor. Darken the coldest door. Nothing to fear but karma's blade. Emerge with your bank account and your charm unscathed. The alarm bell's ringing and your time is up. Started alone, alone, burning. So secret.